Welcome, Life Church Global, to another amazing life experience. We're so excited to have you here with us. It's going to be amazing, especially now that we've started this new series that's called The Divine Alchemy. It's going to be amazing, and we're so happy that you could join us once more.
Yeah, it's so great. Last week's word was phenomenal, so I'm so excited to see what Pastor John's going to bring this week. Let us know where you're watching us from in the live chat. So if you're on Facebook or on YouTube, you'll find the live chat somewhere down below or somewhere on the side. We'd love if you guys could join us on there. There's people there waiting to welcome you. How about this? If you're joining us for the first time, why don't you give us a little emoji or something that expresses how you're feeling today? Because I don't know what your emoji would be, but I think my emoji would be the hands up. Hands up.
Yeah, mine would be the fire, you know, because it's going to be such a fire experience. And before we go on, we'd like to remind you guys, we have a volunteer event happening on the 16th of October for all our volunteers who do all this great work on screen, off screen, behind the scenes, on the scenes.
Yeah.
And you have the opportunity to join us as well and be part of the amazing volunteer group that we have. Just send us an email and you can join the volunteers, and you can join us on this event where we can be part of a family and grow together as well.
Yeah, the other way that you could become part of our community is we have life groups. If you don't know, we now have life groups starting in India, in different locations in India. Send us a message if you want to join them, or if you don't have a life group in your area, send us a message and we'll find a way to get that to you. We also have an online life group where people join from all over. If I started listing the countries, we'd be here for quite a while, so I won't do that. Another thing that I like to remind you guys of is Surge.
Oh my gosh, yeah. Go Surge! What a powerful community.
An epic Surge night last night. It was so powerful. We had a worship night where everyone was just absolutely hit with the Spirit. I know personally, I was on the ground crying, just completely giving my all to Jesus. There were words being prophesied, so I'm going to ask Nash now to prophesy what we experienced last night into everyone who is watching today as we go into worship.
Okay, church, I would like to prophesy into your life right now as you prepare for this worship experience, that the Lord is going to fill you with His love beyond what you've ever experienced before. Amen. You're going to be so blown away. Your chains are going to be broken. Everything that's been holding you back is going to be let free now. And this is how we fight our battles.
Amen.
Forget everything that you've experienced this week, everything that you've been thinking about, holding your mind back. Just let His love fill you, because we are prayer warriors and this is how we fight our battles.
Amen. Wow, so powerful. See
so
you on
excited.
The other side.
Come on, church! Come on.
There's a sound breaking out, Lord, for all that you've done. And now we're turning our hearts to you. And oh, we'll never stop loving you.
Woo!
This will be the best time of our lives.
The best time of our lives as we encounter your
is our place. This is our moment to lift your name. This is our time. This is our place. This is your moment to lift your name. This is our time. This is our place. This is our moment to lift your name. This is our time. This is our place. This is our moment to lift your name. This is our moment to lift your name.
Hey!
This is our time. This is our place. This is our moment to lift your name. This is our time. This is our place. This is our moment to lift your name. This is our time. This is our place. This is our moment to lift your name.
Let's make this personal. This is my time.
This is my time. This is my place. This is my moment to lift your name. This is my time. This is my place. This is my moment to lift your name. This is my time. This is my place. This is my moment to lift your name. This is my time. This is my place. This is my moment to lift your name. This will be the best time of our lives as we encounter your love again. Here with you, our hearts will come alive as we declare your praises. Oh, oh. Here with you, our hearts will come alive.
Hey,
as we declare your praise.
Oh, 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 oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh. As we declare.
Still being raised,
yes, yes. And giants are still being slain. we need a move. And bodies are still being raised. Giants are still being slain. God, we believe. Yes, we can see that wonders are still
alive. Life change.
we are.
Church, we see the miracles that we sing about. We see the miraculous, we see and hear in the testimonies the great and mighty things that God does for us. And one of the greatest miracles is when He created all of us and He breathed His breath into us. So every time that we take a breath, it is Him that we breathe in. And it is praise that we exhale. And I wonder if you could do this with us today. We, as a team, have done this a couple of times. We did this in the ethereal fast as well. And it's just to breathe. It's just to say, yeah. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that
can be seeing that again.
You give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out. In our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise into your breath. In our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. Yeah, 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 yeah. Give life, you are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Great.
You.
Yeah. Great, awesome. You were holy today. Not like you were not holy last week, but that was an awesome time of worship. That was an awesome time of worship. Is it just me that I had a blast. I felt like I was blasted into heaven. Or rather, I should say that heaven was blasted into earth. I think that's more like our doctrine. Are you okay? It's good to be in God's house. Right. Quick hello to everybody online. We've got some ground to cover today. And so I hope you're ready for the word. Anybody love the word of God? Good. I think everybody that was sitting this side came this side. Today we... I like that. Either that or you've repented and come back and God's doing something awesome. Well, I'm so happy to see Alejandra and Sonia in the room today. She's the pastor of the kids ministry and both of them live such a sacrificial life. Every single week, thank you. I ask her, hey, when are you going to be in church? She's like, I am, but you know, she's serving. And then on Sunday again, she's serving on the online content team. And I love both of them. And they're really doing such a phenomenal job. Our kids are safe and blessed. And they're doing awesome, crazy, good stuff. And I absolutely love it. Anybody happy to be in God's house? Man, I'm telling you, every day is the favorite day of the week. But there's something special about today. Right. We are on a series called Divine Alchemy. How many of you enjoyed last week? Okay, that's good, very good. For the rest of you, that's okay. Not a problem. But for those of you who enjoyed last week, that was only a little bit of what I spoke about, what I prepared actually to share. And we're going to get into the message a little more deeper today, okay? I believe God will stretch time. Okay, so if you feel I'm hurrying, it's because I need to get to some place, okay? There's no traffic, okay? But we're going to rush in the word today a little bit, all right? So alchemy is the process of taking something that is ordinary and transforming it and making it extraordinary. That's alchemy, all right? Divine alchemy is God's nature, God's character, and God's abilities, His power to be able to take something natural and make it supernatural. So when God found you and me, the Bible says that we were dead in our trespasses. We were very, very natural. We were the flesh and the cycles and the seasons of the earth and the world. We were succumbed to it, and we had no other option but to do whatever it said that we should do. So Paul in the book of Romans says, do not be conformed to this world. So which means there are patterns, there are seasons, there are cycles that when we listen to it and we come under it, then we get caught into a cycle or a spell. You remember? Yes. Yeah. A spell or a computer program, for those who are like me. We get into a computer program, and whatever is put into us is what we produce. Okay, and so we end up becoming caught in a cycle, in a season, times, dates, all these things become a big relevance to us. And the issue with that is that it only produces things that can fade away. So for example, if you use if you are a business person and you use the logic of business, the knowledge of business, the world gives you, you will be able to have a glory and produce something, but it will not last you very long. You will have to keep doing new things. It's like marketing, you know. Nowadays, you have to you introduce a product, and you have to make sure that it's like, wow, the ad is like mind-blowing stuff, and then it catches everybody's attention, and then after that, they have to keep pulling rabbits out of hats for people to keep buying the product. But when God created something, He doesn't have a marketing plan. When God created rabbits, they continue to multiply. My point to what I'm saying is that when we come under what God has to say, there is a glory that never fades away. In fact, the glory of God in us keeps increasing and increasing and increasing. We go from, listen to this, we grow from glory to glory, strength to strength, faith to faith. We don't go from having a good season to not having a good season. We go from having a good season to having a great season, to having a greater season. And we just keep growing and growing and growing and growing and growing. And we don't apologize for experiencing the blessings of the Lord. We don't feel guilty about experiencing the blessings of the Lord. In fact, we have to believe that it is our right that we have to grow from glory to glory, strength to strength. Amen. So, when we were dead in our trespasses, it means that we were experiencing death in everything that we did. Every action that we did, it caused us to experience death. So, Romans chapter 12 and verse 2 says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed. He's saying, be transformed. So, which means the provision for transformation has been made available, but the choice to be transformed is yours. Be transformed. Do not be conformed. It's your choice to be conformed. It's your choice to listen to the recession. Like they're saying, oh, there's a big, great reset. Well, Baba, the reset happened 2,000 years ago. So don't come under that nonsense that you're hearing in the market. There's a reset coming. The reset already happened. The provision has already been made. What is the provision? A new creation. The old is gone, and behold, all things are new. So now for us, if the provision is there, we may not be experiencing the provision of the new creation only because our mind is not renewed. And Paul says our mind needs to be renewed by the word of God so that we can mutate, ladies and gentlemen, into the image and likeness of the new creation. Are you okay? So every time I receive a revelation of God, I'm receiving a revelation of who I am. Are you with me? When I say I am, I'm talking about the new creation. I'm not talking about John. I'm talking about the new creation. This new creation is genderless, colorless. Oh, come on now. I think I stepped on a few toes. Yeah. The new creation can walk through walls, can be in two places at the same time. Oh, that's okay. When I said genderless, it was like, whoa, what's that all about? Yeah. Well, that's okay. You'll get it. You'll get it. Don't worry about it. But my point to what I'm saying is that God is bringing us into a place. Look, in heaven, the Bible says that we are neither given in marriage nor we're married. But we're like the angels. What are angels? Angels are those beings that have no gender. They're like flames of fire. They're like the wind. Come on now. Okay, I think I'm pushing you too much. So Romans, is in the Bible, okay? So he's saying now, in Paul is saying that we need to renew our mind so that we can prove. Can you put the verse up again? Romans chapter 12, verse 2. Right. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind that you may prove what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. So God has a will, and that will, ladies and gentlemen, is performed by the new creation. I hope you understand that. In order for you to experience the fulfillment or the fulfilling of the will of God, it is performed by the new creation. If you, with an old mindset, are asking God for His will, you are separating yourself from the new creation. You've got to renew your mind with what God is saying about you so that you can become the revelation that He's giving, so that now you have something to prove. Touch your neighbor and say, I got something to prove. It's the good, acceptable, and perfect will of God, right? So what is the will of God? The Bible says that none should perish. The will of God is that none should. None should. When He's talking about none, is He talking about only human beings? I love to submit to you that when He's talking about none, He's talking about all of creation. Because we're not here just to save human beings now. We're here to save all of creation. You must understand that in order for you, like Emmanuel was saying, in order for us to have this pulpit, it has to come from the earth. The earth has to be redeemed. Are you with me? The car that you drive, it's come from the earth. And the earth has to be redeemed. The elements in the earth have to be redeemed now. But only the new creation has the ability to redeem it. Now, I want you to go to Romans chapter 8 and verse 18 and 19. Paul says this, "For I consider the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in." Just remember that now. There's a glory that is being revealed in you. When that glory is revealed in you, it will be revealed through you. Are you with me? Okay? Then he goes on to say, "For the earnest expectation of the creation eagerly waits for the revealing of the sons of God." Come on now. Verse 20, "For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of Him who subjected it in hope. Because the creation itself also will be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God." Somebody say amen. So it's a massive, that like you can preach a sermon series just from that those verses. But I just want to touch on a couple of things. There's a glory that is on the inside of you and me. Every time you and I receive a revelation of God and we renew our mind with that revelation, renew means removing something that you knew and receiving something that is new. And when you begin to apply it in your life, you will begin to see within you first that there's a glory that you're beginning to manifest. Now, that glory, ladies and gentlemen, all of creation begins to recognize that glory. Doesn't recognize you as a successful businessman who has applied business logic and knowledge in the world, from the world, who has all the degrees possible, nothing wrong with it, but you can't say that that's where I got all this success from. Because God is the one who gave you the business idea. God is the one who told you, this is where you put take the risk. This is the time that you put the money here, do this, do that. You can't say, hey, my this education and the business, all the degrees that I have enabled me to be successful in business. Ladies and gentlemen, we have to be very careful. When we do that, what we're saying is we have been conformed to knowledge of the world, and that knowledge has the ability to fade away. But now when we say, I was led by the Spirit, I was led. Why? Because I am a son. Those who are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. When I'm a new creation in Christ Jesus, I am a son of God. And that's what all of creation is looking for. He's looking for sons. But now you and I, ladies and gentlemen, we are not born of God. Please listen to me very carefully now. You and I are adopted into the family. Only Jesus is the only begotten of the Father. There are certain rights that he has. Jesus doesn't need renewing of the mind. The ones who are adopted, who were dead in their trespasses, who had a mindset that led them to only death and dying, need renewing of the mind so that we can experience sonship. Are you with me? If I can take a commoner and add them to the royal family, the royal family has to train the commoner to renew their mind so that they can conduct themselves as royalty. Otherwise, you can take a pauper who has become a prince and take him to an environment where he needs to conduct himself as a prince, but he will still continue to act like a pauper. Ooh. Are you okay? This is very, very important. You must understand that we have been adopted into the family. And because we have been adopted into the family, the provision has been made. But because the provision has been made, we cannot sit down and not say, I'm not going to apply the word in my life. I'm not going to renew my mind. I have grace, brother. I have grace. Yeah, sure. You can claim all the grace that you want and you'll still be the same. But you have to understand that there's a reason why God gave us His Word. There's a reason why the Holy Spirit reveals the depths of the Father, reveals the glory of Jesus, reveals the Father to you. It is the Holy Spirit in you that cries out, Abba Father, not you. It's the Holy Spirit that cries out to you, to the Father. You must understand that we take a lot of things that is supposed to be Jesus's and we think it is ours. Hold on a minute. You have equal rights, but you must understand that in order for you to be like Jesus, renewing of the mind is very, very important. So don't take revelation lightly. Don't take the Word of God very lightly. He is transforming you into someone divine. He is making you supernatural. Do you understand that? The provision has been made, and that is grace. But now, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Are you okay? Right. So saying that, God has developed progressive methods of alchemy. Okay? He has developed these progressive methods of alchemy, and he's embedded, he's hidden it in his scriptures. So that when you come into maturity of being a mature son, now you can use these methods to do what your Heavenly Father did and become like your Heavenly Father. Are you with me? Am I too fast for you? Oh yeah, I'm about to give you my title. And the title of my message is... the title of my message is The Catalyst for Alchemy. All right, The Catalyst for Alchemy. I love it. I'm going to make that my, The Catalyst for Alchemy. Right, so today I want to talk about one catalyst. Catalyst is, the meaning of a catalyst is it's something that you add to something that changes the chemical composition of that thing that it's added to, but it doesn't change. Okay, so when Jesus says, you are the light of the world, you are the salt of the earth, he's calling you a catalyst. He's taking you into the world and he's placing you there so that you don't become like the world now, but the world becomes like? Good. I'm glad we're on the same page now. So, this catalyst, are you ready for what I'm about to talk? It'll change your life completely, okay? The catalyst that we're going to talk about today, are you ready? Is prayer. Prayer. We're going to talk about prayer today. But in a way that you've never heard prayer before, okay? It's a, you know that we don't do things normally. So I would love for you to open your heart and have an open mind when you're listening to the definition, okay? You ready? Are you ready? Okay, now I want you to take this down, okay? The definition of prayer in Life Church Global. Prayer is defined as a meditational harmonizing of our being with the nature and purpose of God. Prayer is a meditational harmonizing of our entire being to the nature and purpose of God. I'm going to repeat it again. Prayer is a meditational harmonizing of our entire being to the nature and the purpose of God in our lives. Prayer, ladies and gentlemen, is not you sitting with a long list like God is a grocery vendor. But prayer is someone that you become. Prayer is you and I harmonizing ourselves through various practices that we'll go through today. Okay? We're harmonizing. We're becoming one with the divine. We harmonize ourselves. We don't go there with our list. In fact, we take our list and we put it on the altar and we go to Him and we say, first, I want to become like you. Second, what is on your will? What is on your heart? What is your desire? And we become one with His thoughts, His mind, and His desire. That's what prayer is all about. See, the prayer that really manifests the glory of God is not the prayer that says, God, give me, give me, give me, give me, give me. I want, I want, I want, I want. And then for good measure's sake, God, we ask for revival in the nations and we ask for, you know, all that kind of stuff. Ladies and gentlemen, that is you talking a lot of words. But God, the prayers that God answers is the ones where you have a desire to become one like Him. One with Him. Are you with me? Right? So prayer is the opportunity to place our needs upon the altar and take on His nature and His will. It is the concerted effort of our whole being to become attuned with the creative spirit of the Creator. Prayer is not just words spoken, but prayer is the process of becoming the prayer. Look, I'm not stamping on what we know to be prayer. I'm just saying, let's advance a little bit. Let's get a little progressive in what the Bible has defined as prayer. Okay, so here we must understand that words, prayer is not just words spoken, but it is the process from which we become the prayer. See, when we study communication, right? They say that that 53% of all communication is body language. So you're speaking louder than you're saying amen to me right now. You know, your body language communicates 53% of what you're saying. Okay, are you ready? 38% is non-verbal sounds. Non-verbal sounds. You knew what I was saying, right? Because you've heard the words before. But 38% is the tone of your voice. 7% is words. So what I understood from that is that because I'm using language now, because I'm using words, 7% of what I'm saying is actually going into your heads. God help us. God help me, man. I prepared so much and came. You guys are learning 58%, 53% of what you're learning today is from my body language. All this drama that I'm doing and sweating and all that kind of stuff, all the hand gestures, everything, 53% is communicating to you my message. 38% is the intensity of my voice. And 7%. 7%. The words that are coming out of my mouth. We spend, just think about this now. We spend how many years? 16, 17, 18, 20, 21 years. And if you did an MBA, even more. Studying language. And it's only 7% of communication. But 53% is body language. But that's communication. Have you heard of this term? Your actions speak louder than your. So what are your actions? Like, think about worship today. Today the worship, I was like, wow. Were you singing louder with your actions? And the tone of your voice? Then you were using words. Some people will scream. Some people don't even do anything. But is it worship? Are you communicating something to God? See, because everything that you do, even the blinking of your eyelids, communicates. Now everybody's become aware that they're blinking. That's okay. Right. When we look at the Lord's Prayer, what did the disciples come to Jesus and say? Teach us how to pray. And when Jesus taught them the prayer, do you know that the Lord's Prayer is more about living the prayer rather than just speaking the prayer? Let me say this to you. The Lord's Prayer teaches us to live as we pray and pray as we live. If you go through the prayer very carefully, you'll understand that the Lord is teaching us to pray as we live and live as we pray. There's something that happens when we pray, ladies and gentlemen. We become, our lifestyle and the choices we make reveal to all of creation our prayer life. We become the very prayer that we pray. I'd love to submit to you this. That prayer only using words is incomplete until you involve your entire being into prayer. What does Jesus say to the scribes and the Pharisees? They're like whitewashed tombs. On the outside, they look really awesome. But inside, these bones cry out. Right? They make a lot of noise on the outside. But on the inside, Why? Because God is more interested in the heart. What is that? That thing about the heart. He's more interested in you becoming His will. He's interested in you and I in a moment of prayer, in a moment of devotion, in a moment of being in His presence, not coming there with the list. He says, I know your needs and I will supply your needs according to my riches, but seek first the kingdom. Seek first the kingdom. Come into the presence of God and seek Him first. Seek His heart. What is on your heart? I'm here today, God, to ask you what is on your heart. I'm not come here to bring a list. You know all of my needs. You know all my prayer requests even before I can pray them. Even before I can ask them. You already know all my business needs, all my family needs, all my health needs. You already know that. But in this moment, what are your needs? What is on your heart? What is your will, God? And give me your will. And then when He begins to reveal His will to you, ladies and gentlemen, you and I have an opportunity there to become, to harmonize ourselves with His will. When we harmonize ourselves with His will, we become one with His will. Now we ask Him to send us out so that we can fulfill His will on the earth. See, that is prayer. Prayer is not just saying, God, I'm standing in the gap for the lost. Oh, go to the lost. Now, let me just push it a little bit more. If you know where the lost are, they are really not lost. have you ever, like we say this to people, no, hey man, you just get lost. No, I know the way. I know how to get around my city. I can't get lost. Are you okay? When people say, you just go to hell. No, man, my name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. I can't. You don't understand. That's not my path. Are you okay? Yeah. Right. See, we have often made prayer, you know, some of us who are very, very religious will keep it to 2 hours, 40 minutes a day. Because it's 10% of the day, right? But what if I told you that Paul says, pray without ceasing. I pray all the time. Pray with understanding. Pray without understanding. Pray in tongues. Pray in the spirit. Pray. He's like, pray all the time. What is he actually saying? He's saying, allow your entire being to be consumed with the will of God. Completely saturated. Your thought processes, everything, your desires, everything completely given to God. His thoughts are your thoughts. His will is your will. His desires is your desires. So what about me then? Well, me died on the cross. Oh, that felt bad, I think. that thing just hurt a little bit. You and I, the ego, I died on the cross 2,000 years ago. When you gave your life to Jesus, you surrendered your life, you made a decision not to live for yourself anymore. Are we on the same? Are we in the same church? We're in the same church, right? Yeah. How many of you have truly given your life to Jesus? Put your hand up. Wow. So all of you, don't live for yourself anymore. I'm asking you. Yeah, there's right? So you're not coming to the pastor for prayer requests. We're not going to one another saying, pray for me, please, 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 pray for me, please. Are you with me? Right. Prayer is complete when your entire being, your will and desires, and the words that come out of your mouth are completely aligned to the nature and the purposes of God for your life. Prayer is the catalyst that you and I need to mutate from an ordinary powerless life to an extraordinary, powerful life. You know, when I look through the Gospels and I look through the life of Jesus, you often see Jesus just leaving people. He'll do a couple of awesome miracles and then he'll just leave them and he'll go away by himself. I always wanted to know what his prayer life looked like. What was Jesus' prayer life like? He kind of blurts it in some of his messages. He says, I only do what I see my Father doing. I only speak what I hear my Father saying. Are you okay? Are you with me? Right? And then there's this moment in the Bible where Jesus, after the Bible says in the book of Luke, he says, after 8 days, Jesus took his three of his disciples, right? And he went up a mountaintop. You know what I'm talking about. Okay, let's go to Luke 9. Luke 9 and verse 28. I want to show you something awesome. This is Jesus' prayer life. This is what happens to Jesus when Jesus prays, okay? And the only reason we know it is because we have three witnesses. One of them said something which was not right, but the two of them, I don't know, don't even say anything, which I think is good. Okay, 28. It says this. Now it came to pass about 8 days after these sayings that Jesus took Peter, John, and James, right? Peter, John, and James, James's brother, and went up on a mountain to pray. Whenever you hear the word pray, it is this definition: harmonizing with the will and the nature and the purpose of God. Okay? So Jesus went up the mountain to become one with the Father's will. He didn't go to find out what his will is. He went to become one with his will. That's the definition of prayer in Life Church Global. Okay? Right. Now, it says this in verse 29. As he prayed, as he harmonized himself with the will of God, as he became one with the divine, the appearance of his face was altered. Oh, come on now. I don't know about you, but the new creation suddenly manifested himself. Oh, come on, man. As he harmonized himself with the will of the Father, the new creation began to reveal his glory. As he prayed, the appearance of his face, started with the face, was altered and his robe became white and glistening. Come on, man. Look, this is for you and me. The Bible says that Jesus became like us so that we can become like him. Come on, man. I don't know, that makes me super excited. As he prayed, as you pray, oh, come on. As you harmonize yourself, you've got to put yourself in this position right now. Jesus, ladies and gentlemen, if you truly believe that you are saved, you must understand this. Whatever Jesus did, you have already done. Oh, come on. Think about what I'm saying. Just think about what I'm saying. We believe that we don't have to pay for our sins. Why? Because Jesus paid for our sins as us. He died on the cross as us. He was buried as us. He was resurrected as us. He is ascended and seated at the right hand of the Father as us. Come on, man. So whatever Jesus has done, you have already done. Oh, come on. So this stuff is not something that is very hard for you to do. Unless you're thinking like a human being now. Unless your prayer life is a humanistic prayer life, needy all the time. Here when Jesus says, as he prayed, the appearance of his face was altered and his robe became white and glistening. And behold, two men talked with him who were Moses and Elijah, who appeared in, say it. and spoke of his decease, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. But Peter and those with him were heavy with sleep, and when they were fully awake, they saw his... Let me explain this to you now. Alchemy is about taking something ordinary. Divine alchemy is about taking something of Christ consciousness, the word of God, the will of God, and attaching it to something physical and transforming it into something supernatural. You're not just doing supernatural things, you're becoming a supernatural being. So you must understand, when Paul says all of creation is longing for the manifestation of the sons of God, what is he saying? There's a glory that you and I are releasing. There's a glory when we renew our mind, there's a glory that begins to manifest. When we receive the will of the Father, there's a glory that begins to reveal through us. That glory, ladies and gentlemen, is the very thing that opens the eyes of all of creation to begin to see the realm of the Spirit through you. Look, how did they see Moses and Elijah? They saw them in glory. Whose glory did they see it in? His glory. Are you okay? Do you understand what is happening here? It's mind-blowing. When Jesus started engaging with the Father, he was not opening his mouth and praying. Come on, man. 53% is body language. 38% is tone, the sound of your being. When he started harmonizing himself with the will of the Father, the new creation began to come out and reveal himself. And when the new creation's glory began to manifest, ladies and gentlemen, everybody's eyes began to open. They began to see in the glory that Jesus was manifesting. In the glory, they began to see Moses and Elijah. Who is Moses and Elijah? Moses represents the law. Elijah represents the prophets. Jesus represents the fulfillment of the law and the prophets. You must understand that the new creation in Christ Jesus is not trying to fulfill the law and the prophets. It's the fulfillment of the law and the prophets. Do you love the word? I love the word. I love it when the word makes sense. But you must understand, you are not just an ordinary being now. You're an extraordinary being. You're a supernatural being. But don't take the renewal of your mind lightly. Don't take your prayer life like just mere words, just standing there and like, oh, shut up, oh God, you know, I pray for this person, I pray for that person. It's good, you can do that. But what about becoming perfect health for someone who needs it? What about becoming provision for someone in need? See, because we reveal it, our prayer life is revealed first through our body language. Have you ever thought about that? That we think that my worship is only when I open my mouth and sing. But God is worshipped when you open your eyes in the morning. Oh, come on, man. When you start breathing, the Holy Spirit begins to... You know, the word breath is actually the word spirit. The word breath is actually translated as the word spirit. Every time you breathe, you're validating your spirit being. You're coming into a place where you understand that, hey, look, it doesn't have to logically make sense to me now in order for me to do it. That is the flesh. That is the flesh. That is the law causing you now to say, do this, do this, do this, do this, and then you will receive from God. But God has already made the new creation as a provision. He's already set it. He's set it in place for you so that now, through the renewing of your mind, you be transformed. You be transformed. You be glorious. But it requires you and I to position ourselves so that we can be harmonized with the perfect will of God. What is that good and perfect and acceptable will of God? God, what is your will for this person's life? What is your will for this nation? What is your will for this church? What is your will for my finances? What is your will for my marriage? What is your will for my girlfriend? What is your will for my boyfriend? What is your will for my school and my education? What is your will? You got to come into that place where you seek God for His will. And when you seek God for His will and he reveals His will to you, don't say, oh, okay, thank you God for your will, and then just finish. That's a prayer's over. You just walk away from there. No, just sit there and become one. Allow the will of God to come, ladies and gentlemen, and become one with you. And that will begins to produce a sound out of you. It causes your body to begin to move. It causes your body to function. It causes your body to move around. It causes a sound to come out on the inside of you. And then you can use words if needed. There are times that when I spend time in prayer, I just sit in silence. When I say silence, I'm saying not using words, but I just sit. And as I sit, I am completely taken into a different experience. And it is from that experience that I begin to engage with this perfect will. What is your will for Life Church Global? I'm about to do a new thing. Wow, you're about to do a new thing. I receive that. I receive that. You're doing a new thing. 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 I am doing a new thing. I am doing a new thing. You got to understand that is prayer. Prayer is not just going to God and giving Him a long list of things that He needs to do. Prayer is becoming the will of God on earth as it is in heaven. Now, verse 34 says this, while he was saying this, that's Peter, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were fearful as they entered the cloud. Phew. They were fearful as they entered the cloud. You must understand, While Peter's saying, hey, Jesus, you know, can we make some tabernacles for you and for, you know, all that kind of stuff. And then a cloud comes and overshadows them and they are in fear and entering a cloud. They're in fear entering a cloud, right? And this is what God says, the Father. And a voice came out of the cloud saying, this is my beloved son, hear him. His beloved son hasn't spoken a word. Peter spoke in a word and God's like not interested in what he's saying. Hear the one who is harmonizing himself with my will. Why? It's because you can see it in his body. You can see it on his clothes. You can see it on his face. You know the ones who have been with God. You know the ones who come into church to be with God and the ones who are with God every day. Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 20 says this. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think. So which means your words that you ask or think, God can do above that. Why? Because there's a power that is working on the inside of us. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to understand something. When you pray, as you pray, if it is the will of God that you're praying and you're becoming, the will, as you begin to communicate, as you begin to engage with God, as you begin to engage with the divine, you get intertwined on the inside. You get intertwined with the divine. And there's an energy that is transferred between you and God. and God and you. There's this back and forth that keeps happening. There's a power that flows from him. You must understand, he gives his word, he sent his word and healed our diseases, which means in his word was the power to heal. So every time you receive revelation from God, it comes with a power. And every time you begin to meditate, every time you begin to harmonize yourself with the will of God, it comes with a power. There's a power transfer on the inside of you. And when your will is put on the side and you say, God, not my will, but your will be done, there is a transfer of that power to God. It's the deep calling unto deep. You become intertwined with God to a point where now God begins to answer your prayer even before you ask them. Oh, come on, man. Oh. Even before you sow into the bucket, he has already created finances for you. Do you understand what I'm saying? This is huge. Even before you open your mouth and say, God, I need, he already provided for you. Why? It's because you made his will a priority. His word a priority. Not just knowledge now, I need to become his will. James chapter 5 verse 16 says this, confess your trespasses to one another. Look at me now, look at me for a little bit, just 1 minute. I just want to say something. The Bible says, confess your trespasses to one another. He's not saying confess somebody else's trespasses to one another. Ooh. Don't confess the church's trespasses to one another. Oh, they should be doing this and they should be doing that, and somehow you decided that you were in harmony and the church should follow you, and now you decided it's not happening now. Nobody's listening to you. Right? So now you started confessing somebody else's trespasses to one another. I don't know, but might sound very yucky, but I don't like somebody vomiting on me. So why do you listen to somebody else's trespasses? Just do that. Just do that. Just with your ear. Just by faith. Just do it. Just yucky stuff all over your ears. Somebody's been vomiting about somebody else, has nothing to do with you. And now you're harmonizing together, both of you. You're in harmony and sync and everything. And Backstreet Boys and all of that kind of stuff. I want it that way. No, no, it's not going to happen. It's only I want it his way. That's the only way. Come on now. Okay, 80s babies in the house. Right. Okay. Let's get back to the Bible. Tony. Laughing at me. Confess your trespasses to one another. Why? Because there's something that happens to the righteous. When the righteous begin to receive or have trespasses, you're operating in the flesh now, that flesh on the inside of you hinders you from becoming one with God. What is the issue there? You have an idol. It can be hurt. That hurt can be an idol in your life. Unforgiveness can be an idol in your life. And you can't go to God and say, God, I want to become one with you. First, forgive. He says this in his scriptures, whom you forgive, I'll forgive. Come on, man. How amazing is our God. Whom you forgive, I will forgive. So why confess your trespasses? So that you can forgive one another. Oh, it'll be amazing if we have meetings like this. You know, Pastor, I want to sit down with you. I want to tell you my trespasses. Not somebody else's. Or we sit down, hey brother, sister, you know, I just want to, I need you. I need you to pray with me. And we sit down together and we say, yeah, man, you know, I had this issue with that person and I'm going to let it go right now. I had this issue with you. I'm going to let it go right now. I'm going to forgive you. Why? Because it's important for me to stand before God blameless and holy and righteous. There's absolutely nothing inside of me that is hindering me from becoming like the divine. And so now you confess your trespasses to one another. And then he says, pray for one another, which means what is God's will for you and me? We sit down together and we ask, what is God's will for you and me? And then it's not like, oh, we sit down and we say, okay, this is God's will. I prophesy, shatarabaraba, hallelujah, thus says the Lord. Come on, give you a prophetic word. No. Sometimes just sit down in silence and hear the will of God. And your body language will begin to communicate it, that you have become one. You're harmonizing yourself with the will of God. What is the will of God? That none should perish. And now you sit down together. And then he says this. And pray for one another. Check this out. That you may be healed. Now, this is what I wanted to speak on for the last 2 weeks. This is actually the point of the message, okay? Says this, the effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. The effective, fervent prayer. What that means is, if God can have an effect on you, He can have an impact through you. Just think about what I'm saying. If God can have an effect on you, He will have an impact through you. And so it's the effective. If God's word is having an effect on you, when you pray, you're building up a fervency on the inside by allowing God to have an effect on you. Come on now. This power is very necessary for all of us to have. Because this power avails much. It gets a lot of things done. A lot of things done. It's not just healing of the bodies. It's not just deliverance. Not just cleansing of the lepers. It gets a lot of things done. But in order for you to harness that power, it requires you to renew your mind. Now, I want to show you in the Bible where this is. Oh, it's time. Stretch the time, Lord. Can I show you in the Bible? Very quickly, okay? No, I won't take you there, but you know the story. When Israel were being led by Joshua, the Bible says that they came to the valley of Jericho. Okay? Are you listening? They came to the valley of Jericho and Joshua now is facing Jericho, and the Bible says that a commander of the Lord's army appears before Joshua with a sword in his hand. And he says, this is holy ground. Take off your sandals off your feet. All that stuff, you can read it when you have the time. Okay? Then he goes on to tell him, see, I have given you Jericho into your hand. Okay? He says, see, I've already given you Jericho into your hand. They've not even taken the sword out of the sheath right now. They've not even spoken in tongues. They've not even had communion. But the Lord is saying, see, I've already made the provision. I've already made the provision of the new creation for you. That's what I'm trying to point at. The provision is already made. Jericho is already in your hand. Okay? Now, I want you, for 6 days, I want you to go around, walk around Jericho. Take your priests, take all the instruments, take all the trumpets, take everything, and the presence of God, and I want you now, not to say a word. Joshua gives instruction to people. He said, don't even speak a word. I just want you to walk around Jericho. What were they doing for 6 days? They were praying a lot. Oh, come on, man. They were praying. Body language. Come on. They were praying a lot. They were walking around Jericho. They were not saying, Shata Rabo Kapa Chichi Dura Rabo Shati in the name of Jesus. Jesus didn't exist at that time. But you know what I mean. But they were like, oh yeah, we're going to have the war. They see that Jericho has already been given to you. Walk around. Walk around. Just walk around. Walk around. Walk around. Walk around. Just walk around. Do something. Do something. Don't just sit there now. Do something. Do something. Do something. You've received the will of God now. See, I've already given you Jericho into your hand. Do something. Do something. Do something. Do something. Get your body to move. Get your body to move. Do something. Do something. Do something. 6 days, not just one day. 6 days. Walk around. What are we doing? I don't know, but we're just walking around. Keep your mouth shut. Walk. 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 Don't say anything. Just walk. Just walk. What did Joshua say? Joshua said, walk. Just walk. Just walk. Just walk. He's received a revelation. Just walk. Just walk. Just walk. What's the revelation? Jericho's already been given to you. 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 What are they doing? It's prayer is a meditational harmonizing to the will of God. Jericho's already been given to you. Jericho's already been given to you. That child is going to be yours. That business is going to prosper. It's already been given to you. It's already been given to you. You're going to have that spouse. You're going to have that blessed marriage. That promise has already been given to you. That's already been given to you. That church is going to prosper. You're going to have enough for finances. You're never going to live in lack anymore. That's the promise of the Lord. That's the promise of the Lord. I'm about to do a new thing, says the Lord. I'm about to do a new thing, says the Lord. What is it, God? Wait and see. See the salvation of the Lord. See the salvation of the Lord. Can you see Jericho's fallen down? Can you see Jericho's fallen down? And they're walking around a city for 6 days. And on the seventh day, Joshua tells the people, when you hear the priests blow the trumpet, I want you to shout. He didn't say, I want you to pray now. He didn't say, I want you to bring out your song list. I want you to bring out your prayer list. He didn't say, use words. He said, shout. The human in you will say, I can't shout. I have to sit. I've been taught to be polite and reserved. But in the presence of God, when Jericho is about to fall after 6 days, it's time to shout, says the Lord. It's time to shout, says the Lord. It's time to shout, says the Lord. One of the words of praise in Hebrew is the word hallel, and it means to praise God till you come out of your skin. It's hallelujah. It's the word hallel and the word Yahweh with it. Hallelujah. It's praise in such a way that your clothes fall off. Not using words. I just feel like the drummer needs to come on right now. Can I have the band up? Because I just feel like we just do one Jericho shout and then go home. Are you okay? Let's stand. Let's stand. I have a feeling that in this moment, those chairs might be restrictive to you. I just feel like you might be more, you might worship the chairs and be more considerate of the chairs and the people around you. So I just want to encourage you to be free. Just wherever, whatever. Yeah, just Just, yeah. And look, it starts with you receiving a revelation. I want you, before we get into that place of shouting, I want you to practice this now. I want you to close your eyes so you're not distracted by what is around you. I want you to close your eyes and I want you to receive the will of God for your life. Just in this moment, just close your eyes and you just need one word. Just ask God for one word. Just one word. You're asking for a revelation of who He is to you. For some, it could be just the word love. But whatever it is, you've got to now, I want you to focus all your attention only on that one word. And I want you to connect yourself with the Father. Become one. If He says love, then desire to become love, not needing love. But whatever it is, that word that God has given you, I want you, as you close your eyes, I want you to begin to feel the energy of that word on the inside of you. The Lord just says right now over everyone in this room that praise is a weapon. His will for your life is not to pick up physical weapons, but use praise as a weapon. Now I want you to keep that word praise on the inside of your heart. And I want you to meditate on that word praise right now. And you become one with the will of God. The will of God is for you to become His praises on the earth. Woo. Wow. I want you to engage with that revelation. Focus on that revelation. Just praise. I want you to only think of that word praise. Nothing else. Don't pray, don't use words in this moment. I only want you to focus on the word praise. Now, I want you to praise Him. I want that praise to begin to bubble out of you, but not using words. You can use movement. Yeah, but do something. Do something. Do anything. Let that energy begin to take control of your body right now. You're the new creation in Christ Jesus. The old is gone and behold, the new has come. Just begin to move. Yes. Allow that energy to move you. This is your praise. This is your worship. This is your prayer right now. This is your prayer. This is your prayer. This is your prayer. You're harmonizing to the will of God. You're harmonizing to His desire. You're harmonizing with what His purpose is for you in this moment. Just harmonize. Yep. Yeah. Let's begin to move. Let's begin to move. It's difficult to do something we've never done before. But I want you to know right now, you are worshiping God. You're engaging with Him. You're becoming one and you're responding to Him. You're allowing your body to manifest that glory that is within you. Allow this music now, just like the priests, allow the music to carry you, allow the music to move you. It's the sound of heaven. Yeah. Allow your body to do something that it's never done before, to reveal your worship, to reveal your praise. For some, you've always dreamed of being a ballet. Just move into it. Just move into it right now. Just move, just move, just move. Just allow that energy to overflow and overtake you right now. There's an energy that is beginning to bubble up on the inside. There's an energy that's beginning to bubble up on the inside. There's an energy. Praise is a weapon. Praise is a weapon. Every movement is praise. Every movement is praise. Every movement is praise. See, I have given you Jericho, says the Lord. Now I want you, that's so prophetic that Ricardo did that. I want you now to begin to release a sound, release a tone without using words. I want you to release a tone out of the bed, out of the depth of your heart. Just begin to release a sound. Whatever sound comes out of your mouth, just begin to release it. 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 Oh, voices. Come on. Come on. Just the drums and the voices. If you feel like running, just run. Feel like dancing, just move. The enemy's been defeated to hold you down. We're gonna lift our voice in victory. We're gonna make your praises loud. Cause the enemy's been defeated. Death couldn't hold you down. We're gonna lift our voice in victory. We're gonna make your praises loud. Shout out to God with a voice of triumph. Shout out to God with a voice of praise. Shout out to God with a voice of triumph. We lift your name up. We lift your name up. Shout out to God with a voice of triumph. Shout out to God with a voice. Shout out to God with a... Here we go! Just in closing, I don't like that sound in closing because it never ends. But we're gonna on the count of three, we're gonna do an extended shout. So here's where we need one another. Because when your voice kind of dies out, your neighbor's voice kind of... So we'll keep a continuous shout. Okay, are you ready to do it? I want you to visualize Jericho falling down. Whatever it may be in your life. It could be habits, it could be finances, whatever, failed marriage, whatever it may be. I want you to visualize Jericho falling down. I want you to visualize your enemies on their knees. Okay, are we ready? Are we ready? Are you ready? Are you all ready? Okay, on the count of three. One. Take a deep breath. Two. Two and a half. Are you ready? Three. Offering is a clap offering of worship and praise to God. Everybody that moves with the rhythm of heaven in this church. Amen, amen. Well, I'm so glad that you are blessed. I know that you are blessed. I know that your life will never be the same again. I know that your prayer life will never be the same again. You know, yeah, I don't know how to land this plane, but bless you. We love you. And if you are, this is your first time in our church, we want you to know that this is normal. This is how church should be. And if you need any explanation, you can speak to Ricardo and Lisa. But yeah, but we'd love to hang out with you in the Connect Lounge. We don't have much time, but thank you to the school and Anish for blessing us with this moment. Anish, thank you. Then we could go a little extra. But man, I'm super excited for what your week is going to be like. I'm super excited for what life group is going to be like. Oh my God, it's never going to be the same. So good. Let me tell you, 50% of your breakthrough is in your attendance. Just showing up. Just showing up, you already received your breakthrough. But I just want you to know that Kelcey and I love you. And we bless you. We really, really bless you. We pray for you. We really believe that God will prosper you this week. Your life will never be the same again. You will be in good health. You will be in good strength. You will have angels that will come and assist you. The whole of heaven will back you up this week. You will make deals that you've never made before. You will prosper in everything that you put your hand to. Bless you, church. We love you.
Wow, what an epic word. I'm still trying to process it. I've never heard of prayer being spoken about in this manner. So it's just so amazing that we get such fresh revelation every single week without fail. This is definitely a word that I'm going to be going back to throughout the week to make sure that I fully comprehend it, because it's something that I've never heard of before, but it's just so powerful to see it in a new perspective.
Yes, I completely agree. For example, today I was with the Life Kids, and it was so nice to give them this fresh perspective and give them a new way to look at communicating with the Word and the Father. It was so amazing to see them actually go into the flow. What an amazing time we had with the Life Kids.
Yeah, just before we release you guys, I just want to declare into your lives that you're going to have an epic, epic week.
So
that
epic.
This new style of prayer is really going to change your lives. Like Pastor John said, effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. And so we're so excited to hear what has been availed in your life. Don't forget to share that with us. We are excited to celebrate with you. So send your testimonies in so that we can do that. Have an awesome week, church. We'll see you next week.